Good morning. Last day, you're still alive, huh? Sore feet? Maybe so, maybe so. Well, I'm so excited to be here with you today, talking about communication effectiveness, and I'd like to jump right in. So how many of you feel like this on occasion? Yeah, or possibly this. Or maybe this, or perhaps like this morning, this, or do we have one more? No, we got that. So, and I was gonna say it in a couple minutes, but I'll just say it now. I've been told you're not so much touchy-feely people. So the reason I use photographs has to do with memory that will happen in your brain as a result of using those photographs. So there's a reason how come I'm using some goofy cat and dog photos throughout my program. So I like to share this video. It's about a minute or two. It's from the internet. And it really summarizes what it is that I'm going to be covering this morning. So let me see if we can get this working here.
Do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Yes, and I know some of you are doing things as far as signage is concerned and text messages are concerned, but really we're talking about the whole gamut of communication. And oh, let me see if I can get this. Oh, sticking. Let's see. There we go. So really talking about communicating more effectively, we want to establish connection, build relationships, even if those relationships involve very short periods of time. Okay? One of the things that I study is something called interpersonal neurobiology or affective neuroscience. And what we can find now in functional MRI scans is the effect that language has on emotional centers in the brain. So what you say actually has a biological, concrete impact on the other person. And for you speaking to yourself, the same thing can happen. So when you're looking at neural pathways and pruning and dendrites and axons and all that good stuff, we actually can change those neural pathways today, if you don't fall asleep, as part of the process. You don't have to do something 21 times or that type of thing. Okay? So people talk about the plasticity of the brain, and they used to think that this only happened in childhood and teenage years, but what we're finding, and this is true even into old age, so we really have ability to make these changes. So rewiring our brains, And when I was looking at NACOM's services that you offer, I found something that was saying, you know, you really want to focus on things that you can implement to save time and money. And communication can absolutely do that. Preventing misunderstandings, talking about feeling valued, which I'm going to bring up here in a moment, really reducing negativity. So, and as far as your priorities and strategic plan, I was looking at the trust being improved with minority and economically disadvantaged people, and providing leaders with additional governance skills. So these communication tips can help build trust and build that skill set. So it looked like NACOM's Turn and Stake Courts just came out July 1st of this year, and three of the priority areas were articles on these three issues: the level of engagement for employees and impact on the customer experience, court customers, which I'm going to be using that phrase today. Human capital was another article that was focused on, focusing on connections and connectivity. And the third thing, there was another article on human capital that had to do with that person who's receiving that message, whether it's a staff person or a member of the public or whoever that is, that they feel valued. Okay, and I think another coordinating group with this is the Center for Court Innovation, and their priorities, again, communications, engaging communities, improving decision-making, strengthening families, all these things related to communication. As you know, helps people feel motivated, decreases toxicity, la, 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 all sorts of positive outcomes. Okay, and this was an interesting article that I saw. Well, actually, it was an address that was given by Indiana's Chief Justice Loretta Rush in January of this year. And she reminded us that court cases are not just case numbers, but they're our neighbors. They're people you would run into at the grocery store, at your son's soccer practice, those types of things. And really talking about adaptability to those customers, to those jurors, to those litigants, to those people filing a document, all of those people really evolving your ability to serve them as well as you can. And keeping that idea of customers at the center of so many of the decisions, which can get lost among operations and dealing with difficult people and the courtroom, et cetera. Okay, and trust is you can build trust. And one of the great ways you can build trust is through your words and how you connect. Okay, so people you manage, court customers, each other, etc. Okay, and as I mentioned previously, there's actually in the emotional center of your brain a physiological experience of rejection. When you experience rejection, it actually triggers an area of your brain, which is a reaction to pain. So it's not just that you have a gut feeling when someone says something that doesn't sit well with you, or you clench your jaw, or you muddle under your breath. I think it's important to recognize there is actually a biological reaction that is happening in you, or when you say something where someone else feels uncooperative or defensive, that's happening within them. Okay, so talking about those impacts. And really my goal here is to offer you practical information, as Will said in the intro, but the reason I use these pictures, as I was alluding to, is research shows something fancy called PSE, pictorial superiority effect. And what that shows is if I show you pictures, you remember 65% more than if I don't show you pictures. So that's the reason I show you pictures, to help make that neural impact in your mind. Okay. So I'm going to be sharing some personal stories today about salad dressing and softball, and it might have, you might think, what in the world does this have to do with anything? How come I didn't make my flight earlier so that, you know, I'm not hearing this? And the reason I'm bringing those stories up is the last point here from Malcolm Tidwell, and that is I'm going to make the message practical and personal, and it becomes more memorable. Okay? And no matter how large or small, easy or difficult, each choice that we make, individually or collectively, alters the direction of our lives. Do you agree with this? Yes. Okay? One word, one sentence, one day, one week, one year at a time, we're building these connections or we're breaking down these connections. And people can be jerks, yes? And we're people. So sometimes we can be jerks, other people are going to be difficult, etc. And when you're having a difficult exchange with another person, it is much more difficult to take the Buddha high road than it is when you're having a symbiotic conversation, yes? Okay, so it's really important, I think, when we get off track, to remember at any moment, directly with the person, on the phone, whatever your situation is that you can stop and do your best to get back on track. And if you get off track again, you can get back on track. But the problem comes when we get off track and we just keep going on that trajectory. Okay, so I'll do my best today not to skip slides, but occasionally I do, and I know that people don't like that. You didn't fly from Washington, D.C. to have me skip slides, so I just bring it up in the beginning in case that comes to play. So one of the things that people find interesting about me, two of the things people find interesting are that I performed on main stage at the Second City and that I am a three-time game show winner. Woohoo! Yeah, baby. And people think, again, what does that have to do with anything? And the improv really is relevant to anything in life, whether it's communicating or speaking in front of a group, etc. And the game show, I just want to share one of my game show clips with you here and let you know the reason I am showing it.
Is this fun or what?
It's excellent.
It is. It's excellent, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
One, two, three, four. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, $1,000. Good. Now you have a total of $2,000. What are you going to do with all that?
You're a student. Now what are you going to do with the game?
I don't know. Put it in the bank.
Oh. That's pretty boring, Karen. But I guess it's good. We'll be back soon so you can make another $1,000. Right after this. Come on.
Okay. I can't see you very well, but how many of you are smiling? Yes, okay, so that's one of the reasons I show this clip is, again, it's much nicer to have a winning conversation than it is to have a clashing conversation. So not hugely important, but just keeps us on track. Let me see here. We have another thingy, and we'll go this, and we'll go that, and we'll go that. Oh, there we go, okay. So this is what I really bought with my money. Okay, good old 83 Honda Civic. I'm 52, so this was my first car. And everything I owned, including my bed, fit in the back of an 83 Honda Civic. So I know some of you in this room are able to relate to the good old days like that. Okay, talking about saying the same things in a different way. When we're communicating, we want people to feel like this or this. Or this, or this, okay? And I'm gonna ask for your feedback here to see, I know it's a keynote in a large group, and I'm gonna see if a few people have some thoughts. This is an elephant sanctuary in Namibia, and this is a place where if the mother elephant has died, baby elephants are cared for by humans for 24 hours on 8-hour shifts. And so if you had to provide an adjective to describe the relationship that you see demonstrated in this clip, what would some of those words be? Nurture, did I hear? Okay. Caretaker? Comforting? Responsive. Awesome. Tired? Okay. Valid point. Okay. Great. And what do you think comfort and responsiveness have to do with the people you're coming in contact with? Do the people you're serving, do the members of the community, do people in the courtroom, do jurors, do family members, etc., do they want to feel that you are being responsive and comforting? Yeah. Are they usually either nervous or angry to be there? Yes. And so it matters. And again, it's not about the elephant. The reason I show you these touchy-feely pictures is to help that point stay in your mind. Okay? So I've learned that people forget what you say, people forget what you do, but they don't forget how you make them what? Feel. Okay? And again, women do this more than men, and there's a reason for this. It's because of oxytocin. But we have a tendency to say things like, do you remember 8 years ago on a Thursday when you did blankety blank? Yes, yes, okay? That memory is sticky in our brains. Okay? Oh, all right. Are we having another fun little, let's see. We going, let's see. Might have to. All right. And so this is kind of a busy slide, but it's really important. And I'm going to actually read this. I have my monitor here. But when we use these types of words and phrases that I'm suggesting, the frequency of their success is dazzling. It has to do with the way we structure our requests. And sometimes it only takes one correctly chosen word, which engages this strong psychological principle, to set an automatic behavior tape in our minds. So this can work backwards too, right? If we have a tape in our mind and an X situation happens, Y is gonna happen afterwards, yes? Because you've been alive for 30 or 40 or 50 years. But this can also work positively to set a new pathway into play. Okay? And Disneyland workers are trained, and when someone says, what time does the park close? They're trained to say the park is what? Open until 8. Same stuff. They're closing at 8. They're open till 8. It's the same thing. But it's very, I'm sure you've experienced this as a frustration. Say it's 4:40. And the court closes at 5 o'clock. It's when someone is ready to go home, they will very typically say, well, we close in 20 minutes, or we're gonna be shutting down our computers in 10 minutes, or these types of things. And the fact is, they're gonna be open for another 20 minutes. So we really wanna focus on this. This is another thing with phone mail tag. If you're calling someone and you leave a voicemail and you say, hey, I'm just running out the door, or I'm running to catch a flight, or whatever the situation is, and you're essentially saying, tag, you're it, I don't want it, it's off my to-do list. And what it's really helpful to say is, if it's true, say, hey, I'm running off to a meeting, but I'm gonna be available for about the next 10, 20 minutes in case you get this message. Feel free to give me a call back. Because so many people now, what do you do when you see the phone ring? You let it what? Go to voicemail. And sometimes people, they don't even listen to the voicemail. They just call back, I saw that you called. And so a lot of times people are available in that window. So much easier to just say, same stuff, instead of saying, hey, I'm gonna be getting out of here in 10 minutes. Hey, I'm gonna be around for 10 minutes in case you get this message. Okay, and I'm thinking usually about a third of the room likes this, but I'm thinking maybe more of the room would like this today. So square root of 100 is 10, et cetera, et cetera. Some people look at this and they say, do people even wear watches anymore? So I understand in preschool and elementary schools, now there's this whole thing about not having analog clocks because kids can't read them. I'm like, you know, figure it out. You can figure out how to do all this. You can figure that out. But really the idea is, again, can you say something in a different way? Can you look at it in a different angle? So who wants to hear the word can't? Nobody, okay? Does your significant other, your spouse, does the person coming into the court, nobody wants to hear, we can't do that for you, we can't take care of that, etc. But it's a common phrase that we say, okay? So we have this here, I don't know how to say this, but you don't have a hamster anymore. Okay, can't find that hamster, no matter how hard I look, okay? So again, I can't help you, etc., etc. All right, we want people to feel like this, and I'm assuming this is not an opiate plant of some sort, okay? So I have a few more things we want people to feel like this, like this, like this, like this, okay? So we want to skip the can't, go straight to the what? Can, easy one to remember because of the euphemism. So a lot of people will say, just like but, well, see, I can't do such and such at 3 o'clock, but I can do such and such, such and such at 10 a.m. And the fact is, within four one-hundredths of a second of you saying can't or but, the other person is having a reaction of, I don't like you right now. Okay, so we want to reduce our use of this language, these words, as much as possible. So whenever possible, say somebody wants to meet you at 3, you can say, actually, I can meet with you at 10 tomorrow. And we give them the opportunity to come back and say, well, that doesn't work for me. But we've avoided getting that can't out into the open and into that conversation. I was going to say one other thing about this. Okay, not coming to me. So how many of you are comfortable saying the word no? Show of hands. Fantastic. How many of you are not comfortable saying the word no? Show of hands. I had about 8 of you. Great. So my research has shown, I know some people don't say this, but my research has shown that if you can confidently and respectfully say no to a person, that is fine. It does not have a negative reaction. But if you cannot say no confidently and comfortably, or you want to have another opportunity in your speech pocket, so to speak, a great substitute for no is actually. And it works personally, it works professionally. You know, say your teenager says, hey, can I take the car out till 1 a.m.? And your response doesn't have to be, what two-letter word? It could be, actually, I want the car back by, and you back by 12, whatever the situation is. So instead of saying, even if you're like, hey, can you meet us afterwards for a quick coffee, instead of saying, no, I have to take my flight, you can say, actually, I'm getting to the airport immediately after, etc. So again, if you want to use no, it can work. If you want to have another word, actually is wonderful. So I don't have the time. How many of you are busy? Yes, two hands going up back there, absolutely. So I'm assuming you're busy. And when we have a to-do list, I'm a crazy to-do list maker. I have lists every day, lists for the week, lists for the month, business lists, personal, okay? So if you have a list and there's 36 things on the list, this is not a trick question, how many are number one? Yes, how many are not number one? 34, okay? So we're not worried about number one because number one is getting your attention. We're worried about 2 through 35, that those people, we want to help them feel important even though you might be choosing not to help them this instant. Okay? So I mentioned the salad dressing story. So this is a story from 1973. I'm 6 years old. If you could read for me, if you're willing, the top right portion of this slide, what are the three ingredients in this salad dressing? Yes, thank you for those of you who participated. And so I'm allergic to tomatoes. So this is not my salad dressing, it's my brother's salad dressing. And I'm from the Midwest, and we were taught there are three parts of the meal planning process. There is making the meal, there is cleaning the table, and then there is what? Doing the dishes, you got it. So my chore this night was to clear the table. Now, did I care about my brother's stupid salad dressing, or did I just want to go outside and play? B. Yes, okay. So I had the salad dressing and I kind of just like throw the cap on, put it in the refrigerator, go on with my merry day. About a week later, it's Thanksgiving, a couple weeks later, and my mom was cooking all this stuff. And again, this is 1973. My mom's in like a yellow gingham apron. She's married for the first of three times, you know, 1973. So we're planning for my grandparents to come over, have Thanksgiving meal, all the stuff. My mom takes the salad dressing out of the refrigerator, goes to shake it. Thank you for being with me. And where does the oil and tomato and spices go? Everywhere. And what does it make? It makes a big what? Mess, okay? It's not about the salad dressing. It's about when you have a situation where you think, I don't have time to deal with this XYZ, the fact is, sometimes when you don't deal with that situation, it turns into a big what? Mess, okay? So a great substitute, instead of I don't have time for, is what I call YIA, your important and. If you are not able to say this phrase sincerely, don't say it, because people know when you are being insincere. Okay? We all know when other people are being insincere as well. We get feelings about that. But when you can say it sincerely, people respond wonderfully to this phrase. You're important, and I'll get back to you as soon as I'm back to the office. You're important, and let's bring this up at the next staff meeting. Any million situations that you can have, but really using this YIA instead of coming up with, I don't have time, but. Okay? So, sorry. When's the time we say sorry? These are very common three-word phrase that we say a lot. How about sorry I'm late? Yeah, sorry I'm late. For the 1843rd time in the last 20 years. Okay, are you sorry? No. Is the dog sorry? No, thank you for buying me a new toy. Okay, I love a tasty mattress. And for those of you who are old enough, I put an end to his curiosity. Curious George, okay? All right, so this is a really powerful thing. I was actually thinking about this yesterday. And I'll give you an extra word on this too. Research has shown that if you're having a conversation with someone and you can videotape that conversation and the person says, sorry for keeping you waiting, or they email something to you that says, sorry for the delay, about 80% of those people will turn away, and if they're interviewed and asked, did the person apologize? About 80% of the people will say no. And you can prove with a video recorder that you said sorry. However, the difference comes if you say, I'm sorry for. So all you have to do is add that first and third word. I'm sorry for the delay. I'm sorry for keeping you waiting. I'm sorry for not getting back. Whatever it is, you can use this a gajillion times a day. And you go on with the sentence. And when recorders are put on these conversations and you say, I'm sorry, for approximately the same percentage of people, 80% of people, if asked, did that person apologize to you? They will say yes. And I know a lot of people talk about this in a lot of venues, but it's less about what you said and more about what they what? Heard. Okay? So what we're saying impacts what someone else hears. Okay? So I have to or I need to. Hopefully I'll get a little bit of feedback from you on this. So what are some have-tos besides eat, sleep, go to the bathroom, and die? Taxes. Okay, great. I can make stuff up, but I'd rather use your stuff. Go to a meeting, did I hear? I hear all sorts of crazy stuff. We'll use go to a meeting and pay taxes. Okay? So, great. So I'll go ahead, okay? So what's the number one killer of men in the United States? And please don't say women. Heart disease. And the number one killer of women? Heart disease. I just separate them because people like to think, oh, it's the men, oh, it's the women, etc. So here's the bad news. Every time we say the phrase, I have to or I need to, there is a shot of adrenaline in our vascular system, there's pressure on our carotid arteries, and there is an increase in our heart rate. And additionally, if you give someone the gift of an I have to, you need to get that report back to me this. You have to file these papers by 5 o'clock today. You're giving the gift of pressure on their vascular system, okay? And this matters. And we say this phrase continuously throughout the day. So maybe the alarm goes off and we think I have to what? Get up. And then we think I have to what? Take a shower, eat breakfast, walk the dog, go to work. And then you go to work and you have to do A, B, C, D, E. You come home, you have to what? Eat dinner, help the kids with home, or whatever the situation. And Groundhog Day, what do we say tomorrow morning? I have to. We say this constantly throughout a day. And we're putting pressure on ourselves. Even when this is internal dialogue and we're not verbalizing this to ourselves or to someone else. So this is my grandma, and again, I'll tie this around hopefully at the end of the program. So my grandma lived 95 vibrant, annoying years like her granddaughter. And this is, I know this is a tricky slide to read, but I was very close to my grandparents. In Chicago, they lived about 30 minutes away, and I just loved being with them and spending time with them and sleepovers and et cetera. So when I was 10 years old, my grandparents moved to Southern California, Ontario, California. And to me, this was like Narita, Japan. I mean, the fact is, I'm not gonna see you for a long time. And I have in this, sometimes people think this is funny, I talk about, this is up in 1983 now, favorite memory, going to California to visit my grandparents, but people look at this and they say, you like John Stamos? Okay. And I'm like, well, the truth is yes, but that's not the point of the slide. It's not the point of the slide. So this is the worst slide that I have in this program as far as visuals, but it's the actual angiogram of my grandmother's heart, and it relates to the point that I'm making. You can see, you may or may not be able to see, there's certain numbers written on this, a certain part is closed, a certain part is 40 to 50% closed, 60% closed, etc. And as you saw here, again, my grandma was 95 years old, vibrant, lived a long life. She did pass away shortly after this, but had a wonderful, wonderful life. So one of the things that I think is so important about this angiogram is our hearts can kind of collect through our lives, like, you know, cholesterol or things if you cigarette smoke, or it's actually things that we do in our lives. You can see that reaction in your body. And communication, can you see it? No, you can't define the impact that someone has on you, the amount of stress that someone provides you, or the amount of joy that person provides you. So it's just this esoteric thing that we can't quite put our finger on. And this is a little bit of a poignant part in the program, but some people find it to be the most memorable part of the program, and then I'll go to a lighter topic, a humorous topic. So this was my mentor, Jen White, and very sadly, Jen passed away of a stroke on her 33rd birthday. And I've attempted to show a picture of Jen here, which shows what I think is how vibrant a person she is. And do you know people in your life, whether it's your in-laws or your neighbors or whoever it is, that I call them ABCD people, people who go above and beyond the call of duty? Can you envision someone like this in your work life? Hopefully you can bring someone to mind. Well, she was really that type of person. And when we think of these have-tos, taxes, meeting, work, et cetera, and even like disciplining, firing someone, dealing with a contentious litigant, et cetera, wouldn't Jen give anything to have that problem? Yes. Okay? We talk about health challenges, we talk about personal challenges, etc. I'm not saying those things aren't difficult or that they're not challenging, but we are lucky to be on 10 toes and 2 feet and be able to have these difficult situations, because that means we're still with the program. Okay? And again, I'll tie this back to the I have to, I need to. So who's this? Me, yes. Some people, I've done this program before, and they say, your brother. And I'm like, no, this is me. So 12 years old, and this is my dad. And if you were to guess my dad's personality from this photograph, without commenting on his attire, what would words you would use What would be words you would use to guess his personality? Did I hear serious?
Introverted.
Introverted? Oh, great. Okay, thank you. Boring, did I hear? Awesome. That's a new one. Awesome. We got boring today. We've got introverted. We've got serious. I think I heard serious. Kind. Okay, great. Kind. Curious, did you say? Okay, great. Curious, serious, kind, introverted, and boring. Okay, awesome. So I'll tell you my story. Well, I'll tell you this. So I consider myself, I'm an up and down person, if you can't tell. I'm the type of person that can go up to like, oh my gosh, this is the greatest thing on the planet. And then I crash to like, oh my God, we're all gonna die, okay? This is me. My dad, I call him a flatliner. He is between 4 and 6 for the last 77 years of his life. And he could be the same, like, I'm gonna buy Brussels sprouts, I'm getting married. They're all in the same 4 to 6 range. Absolutely true, as a matter of fact. Those are real examples. So here we are. You may or may not be able to read the bottom portion of the slide, and I've misspelled there. First place playoffs. So now my brother is 3 years older than me. He wore Coke bottle glasses, so to speak, by the time he was 6 years old. So sports were not in his future. And my dad is a sports fanatic, Bears, Bulls, Cubs, Blackhawks, etc., etc. And so guess who gets to be the sports person in the family? Yes, okay. So I partially enjoyed playing, but I partially just thought like, oh, I'm outside in the nice summer weather, and that type of thing. So for us to be in the playoffs was a big deal. So I was on second, someone was on first, we were down by one run, and there are two outs. So if there weren't two outs, or if no one was on first, and the ball was hit to shortstop, what should I do? Stay, okay? But there were two outs, and there was someone on first. And for some reason, with God as my witness, I forgot. And the person hit the ball to shortstop, and the person from first ran to second, and who was out? And who lost the inning? And who lost the game? Well, technically the batter, okay? My boring, introverted, kind father went nuts, okay? Absolutely, in the whole gamut of his life, he never went as berserk as this day. And we can talk about it now, 10, 20 years ago, he's like, yep. And that was the day, July whatever, 1979. And what I heard him say was, no, no. And we had these clipboards to keep track of score, and he was throwing the clipboard, and he was jumping on the bench, the team bench. And I know this is being video recorded, and I'm imagining my dad watching this now. And the fact was, my dad was actually saying, go, go. And I didn't know this until like 8 years ago. And I was like, and clearly you can tell it doesn't affect me today, right? Yeah. So absolutely, I thought I had to win that game. I had to help with the playoffs. My brother couldn't do it. I had this, I thought, I have to. And the fact was, I made a mistake. And the sun came up in the east the next day, okay? And so words that we can use to stay away from I have to or I need to are these words here. Choose, want, get, I'm forgetting my last one, glad, and verb. And what I mean by verb is, verb to me is the easiest one. Instead of I have to go to work, I'm what? Going to work. Right? Instead of I have to take a shower, I'm taking a shower. Instead of I have to deal with this case right now, I'm dealing with this case right now. You can work all throughout the day to take these have-tos out. And when you're making a request of someone else, staying away from the have-to or the need-to, a great thing is where you could just focus on the request. My request is that. This is what I'm asking for. Again, as opposed to you have to or you need to. Okay? The number one word, I don't keep it for the end, I put it in the middle just to be interesting, that I hope you remember, that you forget everything else from this presentation, is the word why. And I like to be known as the why lady, and the people see me 5 years after a program, they're like, you're the why lady. So this is the research with the, this is the word with the strongest research behind it. And I'm going to invite you to stop saying the word why. And usually, in a smart group such as yourselves, you want to say what to me when I say that? Why or why not? Yes, absolutely. So, this is an African elephant. When an African elephant's ears are forward, that is a sign of what? I think I'm here, like defensiveness, aggression, absolutely. And functional MRI scans show that if we silently say this word to ourselves, even if I say, why did I wear these earrings today? So if I silently say that to myself, or someone asks me a why question, and would you be willing to ask me a why question, and it doesn't matter what it is, because I'm not going to answer it, but. Awesome, why is your hair red? So if she externally asks me that question, like an MRI technician asks me that question, or I personally think silently of a question, research shows that the reaction in our brains to that message is lower on the phylogenetic scale closer to our brainstem and actually triggers a reaction of the amygdala, which causes us to feel defensiveness or shutdown. However, if you start that sentence with either, oh, this is, again, we don't want people to feel this way. This is what we're attempting to avoid. Like, why are you here today? Why did you come in? Why are you late? Why didn't you fill out page 7? Whatever that is, okay? So instead of the why, if we can stick to either the what or the how, we absolutely change that message. Again, internally, what is the reason I wore these earrings today? How come I wore these earrings today? Why is your hair red? How come your hair is red? What is the reason your hair is red? I don't care if it's about something as silly as those examples or why do you want to quit your job? It can be big, it can be small. But the fact is, the MRI scan will show, even if you say the same rest of the sentence, if you start with the words what or how, the message follows a different neural pathway, goes through our prefrontal cortex, which allows us to use more sense of emotional and intellectual reasoning and causes us to feel more openness and curiosity. And so this, in my opinion, is the most powerful word we have to empower our relationship building, even if that relationship is 5 seconds in an interaction with someone. So even if someone says to you, like, why do you guys have the courtrooms on the third floor when I have to, when you're elevated, whatever it is, like, the reason the courtrooms are on the third floor is, or you could, we don't, be like, I don't know. it's kind of a silly example, but you get the idea. And this is the only word that I invite people. I actually have a total of 43 words that I sometimes talk about, but we're just covering several of them today. This is the number one word I encourage you to remove from your vocabulary in your emails, verbally, texts, conversations, etc. And the other words we really look at reducing, but this word can be so important. The other thing is, if someone asks you a why question, like I just gave the professional example, but say you have a grandchild and they say something as silly as, why is the sun yellow? And the fact is, you're actually having this tiny microsecond reaction to why is the sun yellow, even though that sentence seems so benign, you're actually having that reaction to it unbeknownst to you. So when you respond to someone, and even if someone says something to you very threatening, like, why'd you do that that way? Or why couldn't you think of something better? Or something that's really attacking. We want it the best you can, pause, and come back with the reason I did such and such, the reason the sun is yellow is, the reason I was late is. You come back with that reaction book. Typically, if you don't take that second and someone says, like, why do you think you're the best person for this? Very often, what 3 words will we think? I don't know. Or we want to get defensive. Like, who is it for you to say what I am or am not qualified to do? So we want to stay away from those things, okay? So we really want, the amygdala is the key structure in the brain that has to do with these reactions and emotional reactions to words. So it's kind of like a limbo stick, if you have, so to speak. And that is, if you're under the amygdala threshold in your own mind, like if someone says, like, hey, the water cooler is nice with cold water, right? You know, and they say, yeah, whatever it is. But say someone asks, like, are you pregnant? And you're not. That has jumped the limbo stick, okay? So as much as we can, even if we have a series of questions, and I know judges have and attorneys have and jurors here and all sorts of stuff, even if you have a series of questions, people know this very well, you want to do as much as you can to start with the smallest, least offensive question and work up if you need to the biggie. if possible, okay? So I'd like you to read this, if you're willing. I really like this. How many of you lead other people? Yes. How many of you think you're a good manager? Yes. Who thinks so? You think so because you think so. I'm a good manager because I blank, 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 blank. Maybe it's all true. And either an other question or an additional question that's very powerful would be, how about asking those people you lead to say, am I an effective manager? How could I be even more supportive of you? That is an important question that in all our business and all everything, and we think we're a good leader and I'm doing things right and I've been doing this 27 years, and that the fact is, okay, you very well may be right. However, let's get this corroborating information or find out that you may not be as effective as you thought you were. So I like this, okay? So I have no idea. I have no idea when XYZ will happen, when she'll return this thing, when they'll get back to us with the contract, etc. Okay? I have no idea how it happened. Okay? I love this, okay? Police arrest naked burglary suspect. Okay, this person is only a suspect. British police say they found a naked burglary suspect trapped in the chimney of a supermarket. Of course, this is in the UK. Who has chimneys in supermarkets? Okay. A spokesman for the police said he has what? No idea how he got in the chimney. How many ways are there into a chimney? Two. There couldn't be many fewer choices. Okay, so this is, and again, when he said, I have no idea, is that an inflammatory response or a calming response? This isn't gonna help the media, this isn't gonna help the media's perception of the police department, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so again, quick animal photos to help you remember the point. There were some white tiger cubs that had been in a storm situation in a zoo with a hurricane. Moved them over to be with some chimpanzees, had no idea how the chimpanzees would respond. I have a little secret, okay? We have both of them? Yeah, absolutely, okay? So it did work out. Doesn't always, but when someone is asking you this question, so if I have no idea, you can come back with these types of phrases. Bet my best guess, usually, generally, etc. And I know I live in the real world. When you use these types of phrases, people will still come back and say, what two words? You said, blah, 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 blah. However, this helps add positivity to the interaction. Okay? I'm going to invite you to stop shoulding on yourselves and others, okay? When we use the word should, who is it about? You, okay? You know what you should do? You should stay at the Bellagio. You know what you should do? You should see Avengers or Lion King or I don't know what. You can be very well attentive, like, you should come check us out at this new art gallery we're hosting at the courthouse, whatever it is, okay? And you're well-intending, however, you're putting that as a burden on someone else. And the fact is, people are 5 times more likely to do something if it is whose idea? Theirs, okay? So instead of saying, you could stay at the Bellagio, you could see Avengers, you could go to the art gallery, whatever I said, okay? And the fact is, when I say, you know what you could do, then whose decision is it? Theirs. And they're much more likely to do something. Again, does it guarantee you? No, I can't give you that guarantee, but it increases the likelihood. Okay? And sometimes this is not strong enough. You could, those types of things. Stronger words other than could, but without saying should, would be these words in bold. I recommend, we strongly suggest, you can say this to people coming to the court, to each other. My advice is that you, based on my experience, this will take somewhere between 3 and 8 hours, or between 15 and 30 minutes, whatever that is. Could be longer, could be shorter. All right? And a great quick phrase to say to someone when you agree with the person, you understand what that person's saying, and even if they say something just like, this conference was so productive, and you just say something like, I know, or you say, you know, I really have been challenged by this new computer system we implemented. I know. Okay, who's that about? You. Simple change in the moment, just two words. Someone says, oh, it's been so challenging with this new computer upload, hasn't it? You're right. This conference has been so productive. You're right. Yes, it is. Thank you very much. Okay. Simple, simple, simple. Okay. And I'm going to close with a quick word about empathy and then close with a story. So in my opinion, you can absolutely disagree with me if you want, but in my opinion, if there were only one thing different in our world, Earth, third rock from the sun, political, business, family, schools, everything, if people had more empathy, I think it would impact the world more than anything else. And in any case, even if you don't believe that, empathy matters. Empathy is relevant. Just like we talked about at the beginning, people, customers, your staff wants to feel valued. Okay? So a four-word phrase that you can use with anyone who is expressing something to you, even if you totally disagree, or you think, even if they say like, oh, I'm having a bad hair day, it could be big, it could be small, is these four words, how blank for you? Put in whatever you guess that word would be. How frustrating, how exciting, how stressful. And this person, they'll be like, yeah, or they'll come back and they'll be like, no, actually it's that, but you attempt it. And if four words are too much for you, we've got the two-word version. How blank. And you just go there for a moment. This doesn't have to be 40 minutes. This can be 5 seconds. And then you go on with the conversation. So really, really is impactful. Okay? So I like this too. The words silent and listen have the same letters, which I think is interesting. And this was me, 10 years old. And as I mentioned, my grandparents moved to California when I was that age. And at the time, airline tickets were $198 from Chicago to Ontario, California. And we did not have, my mom did not have enough money to pay for that. So I used to babysit for Billy Artemenko here for $2 an hour. And this was Billy about 21 years later or 31 years later? Yeah, absolutely. So he was single, and I thought, well, when you're 10, when you're 11 and 1, it's creepy. But if you're 41 and 31, you know, that's an option. That's an option. Yeah. But Bill met a lovely lady and has a family. That's fine. Good. Fantastic. Good, good, good. Okay, but and this was me going to, this was me at Ontario Airport. So I used to babysit for Billy for $2 an hour, and I sewed this actual velour pouch in 1977, and I would start babysitting in September, I'd babysit till May, and I'd put my $2 and my $2 and my $2 in this packet. And how many dollar bills do you think this pouch holds? 198. So I would add up all my 9 months of babysitting. I would fly to see my grandma, and she would have put the airline ticket on her credit card. And I would hand this pouch to my grandma, and I would pay for my ticket. And I did that every year from when I was 10 to when I was 18. So what? What does that have to do with you and communication? The fact is, as I mentioned, I earned these dollars what? $1 what? At a time. And we can make these changes one word at a time, one sentence at a time, one day at a time. You can make these relationships stronger with your customers, with your staff, with each other. So it's been my privilege to be here with you this morning. I do hope I provided useful material in an engaging way that you can use immediately. And I hope you have a great next couple of hours of the conference. Thank you.